You're listening to the Options Insider Radio Network, the home of the Options Podcast. For more quality options programs, visit theoptionsinsider.com or search for Options Insider Radio Network in your podcast provider of choice. Listeners can also access all of our programming through our mobile app available in the iTunes and Google Play stores. Select programs are also available via live stream at Mixlr.com/options-insider. That's Mixlr.com/options-insider. Don't forget to follow along with your favorite programs and submit your own questions for the hosts at Twitter.com/options, StockTwits.com/options, Facebook.com/TheOptionsInsider, or via questions@TheOptionsInsider.com.
Our next presenter will expand on that volume and break down some of the recent trends we're seeing. Please join me in welcoming Henry Schwartz for the always interesting State of the Industry update.
He had better music, I think. Good to see everybody, and I want to share one thing I heard earlier today is there's 84 people at OIC this year for the first time ever. Which, as somebody who's come, I think this is, might be my 20th, definitely my 8th or 9th State of the Industry. It's very exciting to see new people, as well as all the people that I've known for a long time that I'm very happy to hang out with. So I've been in the business for about 30 years. I've been with SIBO for about 4 years. I've spent the last 18 years at this point looking at options data. People sometimes call and say, I need the guy with the data, that's me. So we're gonna go through a few slides. By a few, that's like 50. I'm going to talk fast. There's a lot of data, and I know that they have permission to send you the PDF. You can always bug me, too. So let's get going. We're going to start out with basically just how big this market is. You don't need to take pictures. I'm going to send you the PDF. If you look at the far column, okay, so this is the last 5 years of some very high-level aggregate stats. I'm not going to go through everything, but as Mike said, total option average daily volume this year, pushing 47 million contracts a day, all-time record. Quarter one was an all-time record for the quarterly ADV. And I just want to point out, the color coding there shows you out of the 5 years how things rank. So all the green is basically an all-time record for 2024. A couple of the, I guess what I would call weak spots, actually are in the underlying volume and notional value. So that's actually a little bit weak, but on the options side, which is really why most of us are here, we're just continuing to kind of set records. A couple numbers I will point out, the $2.7 trillion a day in average daily notional value ranks in the top 10 of global GDP, if we were a country, and the $15 trillion in value of the notional value of the open interest is almost as big as the GDP of China. So let's move on to total annual option volume since options were first listed 51 years ago. This chart shows index options volume is the green, and then blue is going to be your single stock and ETF. And a couple points that jump out to me here is first, you can see the first 25 years were basically kind of weak. It was, you know, four exchanges. There was not a lot of automation. And then you get into 1999 and 2000, and automation really starts to impact the business. The volume growth is really almost exponential until about 2005. And then things kind of level off at around 4 billion contracts a year for almost a decade. Then we get into COVID, and you know the dynamics I'm sure you're all very well familiar with, but you know the zero commission universe, which really kicked off in the late 2017, that's when things started to move that way. And the work from home, you know, we saw 50% volume growth in 2021. Insane growth compared to what we were looking at, that 4 billion contracts a year. Currently, we're tracking for about 12 billion contracts. I think we'll hit it, especially if we get some excitement into the second half of the year. And then the inset box is the market landscape, okay? There's currently 17 exchanges, and this is when they launched. We're going to see number 18 when Miami starts Sapphire, which is going to include a floor in Miami. And I actually left 19 on there because I've heard rumblings of another entrant coming. I bet we would see next year. So moving on to volume, when you break it out by single stock, ETF, and index, which is how a lot of people like to think of things, a couple of things jump out here. So you've got annual average daily volume until last year. You can see the explosion in single stock flow, which was during COVID. That was this retail wave. And you know, people ask me, okay, what are the big themes for this year? And I was thinking about it. I'm like, well, 2 years ago, the big theme was retail, right? And that's where we saw that single stock option volume pretty much double, and it felt like it was almost overnight. Whoops. And then the last year and a half has been zero DTE has really been the story, and I have some slides on that. And when you're coming into this year, I mean, we are running at record levels of volume, but I don't see one single real driver of things. It's really kind of coming from a bunch of different angles, which we'll get into some of them, but it's a little bit more of, you know, we're seeing growth and innovation in a lot of different areas, and it's resulting in overall growth. And I think it's probably pretty healthy because it's a little bit more of a diversified way of things working. And the inset box on the right just shows the growth rates that we're seeing. You know, as I said, single stock volume last year was actually down a tad, but we're kind of right back up to, really back to almost COVID levels currently. A quick slide on single stock volume only and just what the picture looks like. So this is monthly average daily volume. The top 10 are on the bottom and then everything else. Okay, there's about 4,500 single stocks listed. So you got 10 and you got 4,490. Incredibly concentrated and incredibly consistent. You see Tesla, Apple, Nvidia leading every single month for the last year. And there's one thing those names have in common, which is they're very expensive stocks. And so one of the big themes, and this is not a surprise to too many people, but expensive stocks, retail prefers to trade options in expensive stocks. It becomes an alternative to a $900 share, especially when you have weeklies that kind of let them put a smaller account to work. Some of the conversations we've had at SIBO, you know, because we do have equity exchanges too, is regarding stock splits and kind of what that does to the option flow. And the truth is, stock splits are just nothing great for the options world. Things kind of work better when the stocks are expensive. A quick one, I know this one's hard to read. I'll tell you what it is. It's 1 week in shorter duration flow and then everything else, the longer dated stuff. And it's for the top left is all products combined, and then you've got single stock, ETF, and index. And the everybody knows this short-dated flow has picked up dramatically in the last couple of years. It's kind of interesting when you look at it. There's a little bit of growth in the longer dated. There's extreme growth in the front month. And then actually what you see recently, though, is the ETF longer dated option flow is very flat. In fact, I think it's literally within 50 grand of last year's ADV. But the shorter dated is really where we're seeing the boost. And then in the single stock world, just the top right one, a little bit the other way around. You know, there's only weeklies on single stocks. You don't have as many dates to pick from that are going to have a week in shorter. But I think it's interesting to kind of break it out that way. Looking at option volume and the underlying stock volume in the same units. So this is option volume and notional shares, which is the bottom. Okay, so you see we went from under 2 billion shares a day, okay, with would be 20 million contracts a day, up to over 4 billion. And the underlying ETF and stock volume, it's not up, it hasn't doubled, and it's a lot more volatile. So, you know, we have a lot of conversations about this, which is, you know, the option market is just more sustained in terms of the activity that we're seeing. Versus the stock volume is very, very fickle in terms of what the market's doing. The option volume really seems to kind of weather these down moves and these sideways moves a lot better. A quick one on index products, just to kind of, you know, because it is a section in that chart, there's 30, I think there's maybe 42 index products listed right now. I had to do the scale on the left in log scale, otherwise you can't see anything. It's an incredibly concentrated picture in the index world. SPX and VIX, blow away everything by a factor of 1,000. You do see some upticks on some of the other ones, NDX in particular, XSP also seeing some pickup. But it's just it's a really interesting kind of very static world. We're seeing growth, volume growth, but when we try adding new products, and Siebel's not the only place that's tried it, they don't seem to take off. So we just added 3 new MSCI indexes, which we have high hopes for, but we'll have to see. I was the first trade in the MSCI ACW index, if you look at them. Quick one on what's been going on with order size or trade size, really. So when I started in the data business, there were a couple of real simple constants. One was that the trade volume was about 2 million trades a day, and the average order size was 17. That really didn't move hadn't moved for about 15 years. As we went into COVID, but even before that, you see the trade size shrinking, okay? And that's small accounts coming into the market and also much more kind of algo access where people are using smart routers to break their orders up across all the exchanges so that they can maximize the liquidity that's available to them in this kind of fragmented market that we have. And then at the bottom, you just see that as that volume's going up. Now, we actually kind of bottomed out during COVID with an average trade size around under 7 contracts for about a year, and right now we're back up to around 8. The total open interest over time, so like I said, volume is more than doubled since 2019. Open interest is not keeping pace. When somebody trades an option, we do like to see them putting it into their portfolio and then managing it or using it or then adjusting it at some point. The short-dated options, the zero-day specifically, do not create new open interest because they expire before OCC disseminates open interest. So you don't see no open interest created from any of the zero-day contracts. I have some hopes for, as they roll out their new system, maybe we actually can start to get to do some new things in data at the clearing level. It would be great to see. It'd be amazing to see real-time open interest or something similar. And I've also, on my wish list, is early assignment statistics, just something to kind of let people get a handle on how that part of the business is working. Volume versus open interest as a ratio, if you really just look at the dark line, that is the market-wide average of volume to open interest. So if it's running around 0.10, it means that, for every million contracts trading, we have 100,000 contracts of open interest. The main point of this, it has been trending up for that same reason, that the zero-day options don't create new open interest, so the volume ratio is going to go higher. But there's a lot of variation across products. So products that are very heavily retail, where you see a lot of day trading and scalping, are going to have a very, very high volume to open interest level ratio, versus something like VIX, which is a very institutional product. Those trades are going to stick, and so you're going to have a lower volume to open interest ratio. A couple quick slides on volatility. So this top section is just showing what volatility looks like. Okay, simply the size of the swings in the S&P 500 for this chart, and you can see those these clusters of extreme volatility. 2020 being the biggest one we've seen in the last decade, and then the bottom section is simply the implied vol over the realized vol for S&P 500 using VIX as the S&P vol proxy, and then lagging it so that the timing matches. And this is really just to show that, in general, volatility, implied vol is going to be hanging out above realized volatility. There's plenty of reasons for that. And then every once in a while, you get these big spikes where the realized blows through what the implied had implied for the future, and that's when the premium sellers, VRP harvesters, sometimes they're called, get kind of killed. So we're kind of back to normal, basically, in the last 6 months. But this obviously is where a lot of traders put a lot of their effort in trying to execute this strategy. And actually, it's funny, a good friend of mine who used to trade with, I was talking about the VRP, and he said, it's kind of bullshit, because you can't just trade the VRP. You have to have an approach to doing it. Okay, this is trying to harvest that extra bit of implied vol over the realized. if you look at the zero-day options as one way to do it, and this is one of the reasons the zero days are just so popular, is there are a million ways to kind of play with and dissect the data. And this chart is simply showing what would happen if you bought the daily straddle every morning at 9:35 and held it into the close. Okay, this is about 7 or 8 months of worth of data. And you can see basically there's up days and there's down days. The inset shows the summary statistics, though. In general, it's a slightly losing average. It costs you about 49 cents a day on average, but in surprisingly fair valued. You know, there's certainly pockets where, you know, you see that beginning section where owning the straddle was a loser for almost a month in a row. If you're on the sell side of that, you're making money. But, you know, from talking to customers and talking to practitioners, you know, the devil's in the details, which days you decide to sit out, what do you do around Fed time and all that kind of stuff. So, but it's one of the reasons that, you know, it probably still is the most common conversation that we're having at Cboe, because SPX was the first place you could trade 0 days options, but now you can trade them on a bunch of liquid ETFs. Quick one on volatility, the shape of the volatility smile. This concept is lifted from my friends at Karmica Partners. And but I really like the idea, which is simply to say, look, this is what a vol smile, a vol skew looks like for one expiration. And they basically just want to show where there's kind of supply and demand pressure that's moving the structure of this vol curve around. And it is creating opportunities, and it's also kind of letting people infer sentiment, right? So if you see, you know, an enormous amount of upside speculative call buyers, which is the far right arrow, you're going to see that in the shape of the curve, you know, versus if you have a bunch of panic put buyers, you're going to see it in the shape of the put side. So I like the way of thinking of this. And then the other thing it occurred to me as I was making this is this definitely impacts the shape. We see that, and a lot of the conversations this year have been about skewness, and I have a slide on that. But the other thing that's really that comes into this is the level of the curve. So if realized volatility has been 25 for the last 2 months, where do you think the at-the-money vol is going to price itself? Okay, so Dean Kernot at Macro Risk kind of talks about VIX being a backward indicator in a way, because it's telling you, well, if you were shorting vol at 20 for the last 2 months and you got killed, then 25 is probably a better level. So that combination of kind of what the market is really realizing in terms of vol, plus what the supply and demand is doing is kind of how we get the vol structure. And this is a quick one on what that vol curve looks like into a catalyst. So, and this, I got to tell you, I traded for about 15 years at banks, and I never kind of had a good handle on how to handle a single stock into an earnings event. Any other catalyst, like a, you know, a Fed release, would do the same thing. That little W-shaped curve is the volatility shape, I think this was for Visa, into earnings. And really what that's showing you is that you have, the market knows after earnings that this stock usually moves 3 or 4%, right? You have the historical data, we provide it, but find it in a lot of places. That, to reflect that higher probability of ending up or down 3%, you end up with this volatility curve that's basically just, there's lower vol at that, those 2 points, because there's a high chance we're gonna end up right at one of them. So being able to price that properly, I think is a relatively new innovation, and it's why we have, you know, kind of liquid markets into catalysts as well as normal days. I talked about skewness, that put call skew. There's five lines on this chart. The bottom three are simply the at-the-money vol level, the 25 delta put vol level, and the 25 delta call vol level, right? At-the-money vol is kind of in the middle. Your put's always higher. Your call's always lower in the index world. In single stocks, it can be pretty different. And those track together, right? When we have a panic, people just come looking for puts, right? They panic and they buy puts. If you separate the put vol minus the at and the call vol minus the at, you have two separate things you can look at, which is what the dashed lines are. And so this is definitely one of the most interesting topics for the last year or so, is the closeness of those two options in terms of implied vol. I mean, where we are right now is there's only about 2.5 vol points between a 25 delta put and a 25 delta call in the S&P 500, which is historically cheap and historically low. And you can read into that sentiment and you can read into that supply and demand. It certainly means anybody who wants to hedge a big portfolio can get it at a price that's a heck of a lot better than it was, you know, a year and a half ago. But why that's going on and kind of if it's related to market activity, if it's related to supply and demand of volatility is also a big topic of discussion at plenty of meetings. Market structure. So we have 6 operators and 17 exchanges, as I said. This slide hasn't changed very much in the last 7 or 8 years that I've shown it. However, we do have MIAX with one on the board to be launched later this year. And for people that aren't super familiar with it, basically you have 2 primary pricing methods. You have payment for order flow, which is kind of the traditional style, and you have maker-taker pricing, which is slightly newer. The different kinds of order flow are basically attracted to each, to one or the other. And so each exchange operator wants to at least have one of each, because then you're kind of capturing the flow regardless of whether it's somebody taking a quote, in which case they probably want to get paid for it, or somebody who's going to be resting on a bid, in which case you'll get a credit as a maker taker. The pie chart of volume by exchange, I think it's year to date as of a couple weeks ago, and I know if I'm off by even one decimal point, Shelley Brown and others will tackle me in the hallway, so I was very careful with this data. One time I got it wrong, and Shelley let me know. We have 17 exchanges. I get plenty of questions on why do we have 17 exchanges? Is this really necessary? And my answer is, look, they're all doing activity. They all have a decent slice of the volume, so they're meeting some need. Okay, yes, it makes the market more complicated. Yes, it makes it pretty tricky for liquidity providers. But we've been meeting this challenge. And so, God, I mean, one of the first OICs I'm sure I went to had a panel on is 6 exchanges too many? Okay, well, we're at 17. And we don't even have a panel on is 17 too many? Okay, moving on. Market share for each. Just really to put a pretty slide up, you can see where we've gone from basically 6 exchanges, you know, all with a decent slice, to 17 exchanges, even MEMEX at the very top, with a visible piece of the activity. I've been, you know, at an exchange now for almost 4 years. Incredibly competitive, incredibly dynamic, right? People are working their butts off to figure out what the participants want in terms of where they're going to send their orders. If you look at it in terms of the operator market share, which is, you know, like I said, we have 6 operators, so that's, you know, really probably what most people are thinking about it, right? We don't really care if it's which of our exchanges it's hitting as long as it's hitting our exchanges. You can kind of see, you know, some interesting impact, right? Cboe and NASDAQ are the 2 bottom. Who've seen the market share eroded by basically, the new entrants, you know, especially, MIAX in pink. And even Box at the top taking a bigger slice. So, and then, you know, but if you look at the pie charts, it doesn't change a lot year to year. Like I said, I think that's just because it's incredibly competitive. People are making strategic changes to attract order flow, and then other exchanges are competing with that. Clearing type. This is actually pretty interesting. So OCC distributes the breakout of volume by customer, firm, and market maker, just those 3 segments. So if you sum it all together, you can see that bottom line, the green line, is the firm activity. Okay, that's banks trading against their own clients, which is what I used to do. In general, because either you have to, because you can't get a big enough quote for the customer, or because you want to. But I use that firm activity at the bottom as kind of a proxy for the big hedge fund and asset manager flow. Very flat. In fact, it dipped during COVID. Even though volume was kind of in the process of doubling, the firm volume was shrinking at the time. It's recovered, but there's not a lot of growth there. Where the growth is in the 2 top lines, which is customer volume and market maker volume. So the way the ecosystem works for customer flow is, in general, a broker is going to send it to a consolidator. who's going to match it up, send it to an exchange for execution. That's why they track together. Every order that you send to somewhere like Robinhood or something is going to a consolidator. And in general, that's going to match up against market makers. What's interesting in the last year and a half is the market maker volume has continued to climb while the customer volume is actually leveled off. And you know, when I was on the floor 100 years ago, you know, market makers all just compared notes. Like, what do you got this one worth? $7. Okay, let's all be, you know, 6 3/4 or 7 1/4. Market makers did not really want to trade with each other. That wasn't the business. That's changed, and it's changed a lot in the zero-day complex, where if you ran this just using the zero-day, which you can do with the open-close data from Cboe at least, you'd see it's even higher. So the market makers are trading with each other much more actively than they have been. So it's like when people ask me, well, where are we going to see the growth this year? And I said, well, it's coming from a lot of different places. One of the places it's coming from is market makers being much more active about trading with each other. In the zero day, in a lot of cases, it's simply to manage strike risk, right? So, but in the zero day also, you have more models, more ways of trading. People are using the zero day, they're using different pricing models to begin with, but they're also using it for different purposes, delta adjustment, situations where they're happy to go pay the offer, even if it's against another market maker. A couple slides on the more on zero day. This is also pretty interesting. So like I said, it's the zero day is there's very little firm activity in the zero day options, which I read into that, meaning that the hedge funds are just not really interested in trading them. Okay. But, and that's why it's almost all customer to market maker. And it literally was just all customer to market maker at the beginning. And now these bottom lines, the pro-cust and the firm lines are definitely trending higher. And so that's showing us that more people are basically coming into the market saying, well, okay, you know what, these are very liquid products and I'm starting to understand what they're useful for. And the customer volume in it stays very strong and we get these new participants coming in. So slide on proliferation. This was also usually a topic at the other OIC conferences. The black line on there is the number of underlyings that options are listed on. So into COVID, we were actually at a multi-year low, almost a decade low, I think, of 4,200 underlyings that had options on them. So that's all the ETFs, indexes, and single stock names with options. That over COVID with the IPOs and the SPACs and this incredible list boom in active ETFs, and ETFs that use options within them, which we'll talk about, we shot up to almost 6,000 listings. At the same time, we were throwing in more short-term expirations, right? So the shaded parts are actually the number of strikes, the number of contracts that are listed out there, all the strikes times all the expirations. We used to talk about this million option threshold as being something we should be very concerned about. A million options is a lot to quote. A million options is a lot to be able to show your customer in a brokerage platform. We blew through that during COVID in an instant, basically. And as more shorter-term expirations were layered in, we're now pushing 1.6 million individual listed contracts at kind of into expiration, and then it usually resets a little bit because the strikes come in. So the number of listings has kind of tailed down a little bit, but there's a pro and a con on this. The pro is like a customer can pretty much trade almost anything they want. Right, there are options on almost anything that's liquid, and there are strikes and expirations all over the place. The con is that for a new client, it's a little bit messy to. I was just talking to somebody about, well, if you want to pull up the SPY option chain, you've got 52 expirations to go through. You know, that's messy and kind of requires a different approach, which is an opportunity for the broker dealer community and platforms and vendors to come up with much more intelligent ways to find an option trade or make a trade than just looking at a ginormous chain of options like we used to do. The listings by option type, by underlying type, I mentioned that ETFs, the ETF business has been a huge part of the growth. And in fact, since COVID, we've added 1,500 new listings. 600 of them are single stocks, and 857 are new ETFs with options on them, okay? So bigger growth in the ETF world than we're seeing in the single stock world. This is There's basically a gold rush going on in the ETF creation business. We see that every day. And there's also a lot of creativity and innovation and people creating ETFs that sell options. So you can just buy an ETF instead of opening up an account and getting options, selling permission, and then trading it that way. You just can buy a product like QQQY or one of those. Concentration slide. So I've done this one for most of the time, mostly to show that we have an incredibly concentrated universe. I showed on that first slide the top 10 stocks make up about 35% of the single stock world. Across all products, the top 50 make up 70% of the total volume. So people talk about the 80-20 rule. I think for us it's the 82 rule because we can have 6,000 listings, but once you get away from the top couple hundred, the volume is very thin. It doesn't mean that they're untradeable, but it means that people have to kind of take a different approach to get good executions, which a lot of people here put a lot of brain power into. If you do this in premium terms instead of volume terms, the picture changes a little bit. Okay, primarily SPX, which is a $50-$100 underlying, jumps to the front, about a third of the daily dollars that trade in our market, which on that first slide was about $27 billion. About a third of that is trading in SPX. And then it's still the names that you're probably most familiar with, but again, those high dollar stocks are where a lot of customer flow is attracted to. A couple slides on trade size. I used to show this, and in my spreadsheet, it's called the Robinhood slide, because I used to say, well, these are one lots. These are going to be your smallest customer accounts. And also, it really starts to kick up at the end of 2017, which is when they started their zero commission options business. I've been corrected on it enough that I will take that back and say this is definitely a lot of retail and it's a lot of algorithmic access. So just looking at the smallest possible trade you can make, you see us in terms of volume going from not even 400,000 contracts a day to over 3 million contracts a day in a pretty short time. Now making up around 8% of the average daily volume is in one contract trades. If you slice it and dice it a little bit differently, this is the same concept, except now we're looking at 1,000 lots and 5,000 lots. That's the bottom lines, okay? High size, basically the negotiated high touch flow. It certainly rebounded from the COVID, the pain in COVID, but there's not a lot of growth there. Where the growth is in it is everything else, the smaller sizes, right? So the 1 through 10 lots, which is the dark blue line, shooting up and then kind of leveling out. But, the 1 through 10, the 10, 11 through 100, and then even all the way up to 1,000, that's where all the growth is. That's people using algos and smart orders to take their 2,500 lot and instead of executing it with a voice broker, using somebody's or creating their own smart routing software to do it. I don't think there's a lot of new people coming to the market that are running voice broker type of portfolios. Retail flow, like I said, this was kind of the hottest topic of the last couple of years. Using the 606 data, which has only been around since 2020, you can actually, most brokers publish their traded volume. So you can see on here, you can rank them. You can pretty much see they are reporting what they're executing in general. You can see kind of that spike for everything in 2020. Okay, I have a slide where it's all added together, don't worry. And you can also kind of track the brokers that are seeing some growth and the brokers that are kind of seeing some kind of static levels of activity. If you add them together, this is what you get. So you actually can see we went from the very beginning on the left, under 15 million contracts a day of retail flow. This is, although Interactive Brokers is included in this, they're certainly going to have some professional retail or pro-tail, going from 15 million to 25 million during that incredible bounce off of the COVID lows. And it's pretty much stuck. So, and then in terms of market share, it's when I started in the business, retail was probably about 10 or 15% of the activity out there. That was what the brokers were willing to admit to. We're seeing it consistently 50% of the flow easily. The other half's going to be your institutional clients. Quick one on open outcry versus electronic. So you can see that dip in the floor traded stuff to zero when the floor is all closed during COVID. Again, relatively static when it comes to floor traded flow, while the electronic is where the growth is. Now, what's interesting about this is, you know, it's still whatever 5-ish million contracts a day trading open outcry, and we see a new floor opening up. So. A while ago when I ran some numbers on Box, just looking for the flag for electronic versus floor, I saw almost half of their volume for one of the months was floor-based. Okay, not half the orders, but the big orders are going to the floor, and it was almost half of their flow. That's why people are still opening up floors. Complex order activity. So for a long, long time, 70% of the index flow was complex. You didn't have to think about it. 30% of the single stock and ETF. That's changed primarily because of the zero-day activity. So that zero-day flow has diluted the complex activity. In general, although a lot of the zero-day flow in all the products starts out as a complex order, it tends to be closed as individual legs, whether it's closed for a profit or closed for a stop loss. And that's impacting both the index and the single stock complex activity. Some of the innovations I think they're most exciting actually though are going on in the complex order execution world, both at the exchange and at the broker level. So I think it's still a very healthy segment with a lot of growth to happen. Just a snapshot of complex orders, what actually trades. This is a month's worth of activity that we compiled. If you've traded options, vertical spreads are probably the very first thing you would think about, and then maybe a calendar or a diagonal spread. That's kind of how it all shakes out. You know, the more esoteric spreads are less common as you go around the wheel, and just some examples of what those spreads look like. Liquidity. So a couple ways to look at this, and I do have a new slide here as well. So simply looking at the basically midpoint to offer, that spread that a customer would have to pay cross to get a fill. Across all products, it's not a perfect calculation, but it gets you in the ballpark. You can kind of see that we were averaging around 20 cents of bid offer across everything. Pre-COVID shot up to super wide during COVID, and we're still kind of hanging out wider than we've been. Okay, part of this though is attributable to the fact that the notional value of the market is up 50% since 2020, don't forget that. And then the green line is the price improvement. So the experienced bid offer is better, right? Because a lot of orders, especially retail, but also institutional orders, get crossed a little bit better than offer. So the one thing that like stresses me out about this is I like to see a quote, a nice tight quote on the screen, because that is the advertisement that we're making to somebody new. If they look at a screen and the market is a dollar to 102, they're like, geez, that's not too bad. If I change my mind, I'm not going to get killed. The bid offer matters when, you know, it's not fair to tell customers, well, you have to understand price improvement is going to come into play. You're always going to do a little bit better than the offer. We know that, but new customers don't know that. So, quote size, another way to talk about liquidity. This is simply adding up the bid side and the offer side volume, the shown size, across everything again. You can see, you know, pre-COVID, we were kind of at all-time highs, you know, almost 900 up on average. And then that gets sliced way down when we go into this kind of crazy, volatile, scary times. And then we've kind of come back to almost where we were before. But I want to show you something pretty cool. So this is something that that Nishank Modi, who's on our Cboe Labs team, has been working on. And it's a way of saying, okay, fine, what is liquidity? It is size and bid offer, right? And the way that he's laid this out, and there was some talk about making this even a tradable index, is simply quantifying the shown vega of all the bids and the offers, normalizing it to the 30-day term, okay? And then there is a correction for kind of average bid offer, but you can kind of forget about that for now. And what's interesting here is, and the units actually, the 1,500 is $1.5 billion in vega shown, okay? So this is the sum of all quotes, all the bids and all the offers, how much is out there. And you can see, you know, in SPX kind of how it dips and how it kind of, you know, reacts to different market conditions. And then you can actually see where SPY comes out too. Obviously, Siebel loves to kind of talk about our, you know, how liquid this product is. If you ever trade SPX, it is crazy liquid. If you put the CME E-mini complex of options in there, it kind of comes out right around the middle. So, and then you can do this on an intraday basis. So this is August 4th, when if you were trading, you would remember pretty vividly, we were up 50, and by the end of the day, we were down 50 in the S&P. So it was a 2% swing from top to bottom. And it all happened in the last 2 hours, because somebody from the Fed said something. But the liquidity index, right, quantifying it this way, was chopped in half pretty rapidly. So the ability, I love this just in if you're coming at the market and you want to know, is this a decent time to trade or not, or are conditions deteriorating or are they getting better? You actually have a way that you can kind of just look at a number and go, okay, this is a good time to trade or a bad time to trade. And then you could also do this across different products. You could compare one to another. So some more on the zero-day options flow. This is, again, this is SPX because that's what I have the easiest kind of comprehensive data to. But you can see where we were when these things were rolled out in May of 2022, when the Tuesday Thursdays were added. We've gone to basically almost, you know, 1.5 million contracts a day, which is 50% of the volume in that product. Whereas the longer dated stuff has really, it's actually continued to climb a little bit as well. So, you know, this is why we get a lot of questions on like, well, the 0 day is just stealing volume from the 3 week options. People are just trading the 0 days instead. It doesn't seem like it. I'm sure some of that's going on. And then if you look at the average trade size, I think is actually pretty interesting too, is the 0 day is the green line at the bottom, and it's under 4 contracts average versus the rest of the product, which is around 12. So not only, these are cheaper options because they only have hours till they expire, right? We're still seeing smaller trade sizes in there in general, which kind of shows you that it's a different community trading that product. So the execution type, this is a kind of cool one. I snuck this one in after I'd already sent it out the deck. The 0 day option flow in SPX at least is 98% electronically executed, okay? Versus the non-zero day, which is not even half, it's more than half, 60% electronic, but very, very different access. I was in the crowd talking to a guy I used to work with. I'm like, and he trades SPX. I'm like, what do you think about the 0 day? He's like, we don't even pay attention to it. It's on the screens over there. It's doing what it's doing. Somehow it's trading 1.5 million contracts a day, but it's very different. It's very separated from the longer dated execution. Longer dated contracts. And in fact, most of the market makers I've talked to, basically if they do, you know, the teams that manage liquidity for the 0 day are separate from the longer dated desk. It's not really the same animal, even though they're both listed options. Just a quick slide on seeing how we got here in terms of the 0 day. Shelley at Staney a couple weeks ago pointed out, well, this might be because they just weren't out there. There weren't daily options back in 2016. This is definitely true, but it has been a very, very steady climb. So every one of these lines is the market share of the days to expiration. So where you can see we're running right now is 21% of the total volume is in the same day expiration, and that's just been climbing every year. I would say that it kind of, from what I've seen, things are somewhat stabilizing in there. They did add, not dailies, but they added Wednesdays in a handful of ETFs, GLD, USO. The market share in there is like 10%, so it's picking up some activity. But even in Russell, where there actually are dailies available now, we don't see the kind of flow that we see in SPX and NASDAQ. So, and in fact, here's all of the products that currently have daily options and what the market share of the zero-day flow is. So at the top, it's funny, it pairs off by the index and the ETF. NASDAQ and QQQ at the top, 52, 3, 4% of the flow in there daily is options that expire same day. Then you have SPX and SPY, and then an XSP, and then Russell and IWM at the bottom. So like I said, it seems like the when you get away from kind of these super duper well-known products, you just don't get quite as much activity in there. A couple on this zero-day strategy. This is based on some on SPX data compiled by my ex-associate Jonathan Zions, who's here. But the flow in the zero-day, at least in SPX, is pretty consistently led by premium sellers in the morning. Okay, if you think about, and customers tend to trade SPX as a vertical spread because the market, I think the margin on a one lot in SPX is about $100,000. So you don't get a lot of uncovered premium sellers. But what you do get is people selling vertical spreads in the morning, okay, and then covering them later in the afternoon. So that's why in the morning you see the vertical, in that first half hour, 40,000 contracts sold in the form of vertical spreads versus only 7,000 bought to close. So, and that's kind of how it goes. Another thing that's kind of interesting in the index flow versus the ETF flow for the zero day is at that last hour of the day, because most of the retail brokers kind of blow their customers out of the zero day SPY, there's a waiter that works in the cafe here who told me he trades SPY options and Tesla dailies and weeklies regularly. I was very, very impressed to hear that. But he started talking about how you know, they blow them out at 2:30 or 3 o'clock in the afternoon. In the indexes, that doesn't happen because you really don't have to worry about the delivery, the cost of taking delivery. So it's a little different when you, if you did this for SPY, you'd kind of see it really tailing off at the end. Flex options, this is one of the most, I think, most interesting, exciting areas that we have. Flex has been around for 25 years. Customer gets to decide the expiration date and the exact strike that they want, and whether it's American style or European style. For index products, you can actually do Asian and Clique, a kind of an exotic expiration. They're also really hard to kind of keep track of. They're distributed over Opera in this form of this really ugly string of text. Basically, very few people know what's going on. Cboe happens to trade half of them, and we trade most of these things electronically. But that volume has continued to grow, and I have a slide on kind of where it's coming from. It's now pushing it. Actually, in April, it was 1.5% of the average daily listed volume was in the form of flex orders. So continues to be a growth area, and there's room for all sorts of cool innovations there. You know, whether it's at the exchange level, the broker level, or the vendor level. And here's a couple examples of I don't know what I'm on for timing because the clock's not moving, but a couple dominant reasons we're seeing this flex activity. One is in these defined outcome ETFs. So I said that there's this gold rush in ETF creation, right? The buffer protect, these families, you know, Innovator and Global X coming out with ETFs that really meet, they really hit a sweet spot in terms of some customers. You can buy S&P, but I guarantee you're not gonna lose more than 8% in the next year. Some customers are like, well, that sounds great. Oh, by the way, you have to give up, you know, 7% upside. There's still customers that are like, I love this. So they tend to trade those in flexes because they can get the exact trade characteristics they need. In this case, you can kind of draw the line from this ETF, which is one of the innovator ones, where they're giving the customer an 18% cap. You can actually see the 18% out of the money call. And so based on the expiration, you can see it all. So 10 minutes, perfect. The other thing that's is driving a lot of the flex activity is the RevCon business. I got a phone call from a guy a couple weeks ago. He's like, I need to see the Euroflexes. I'm like, I don't know what you're talking about. I've been in this business for 30 years. Euroflexes, come on, I need to see Euroflexes. Apparently, it's a buzzword for the European style RevCons executed in flex. Okay, the trade, if you're not into it, is simply a stock loan style trade. They use European style options because they don't want to deal with any early exercise or dividend considerations. European style options are perfect. And so this is just an example of one in Etsy. It's simply a call and put combo against a share of stock. That's all it is. But that's been a big piece of the business. In fact, we're up to 20,000 individual flex open interest positions are out there now. That's up from about 7,000 a couple years ago. So this is a continuing piece of the business. Like I said, there's very cool things. We're at SIBO, we're sticking analytics on all the flexes, so you can say, okay, well, not only did this trade, you know, print at $1.50, but the theoretical value was $1.38. So now you're like, okay, it looks like it was a buyer, and we can put the Greeks on it and everything else. So, and here's the open interest, as I said, almost 20 million contracts a day, like I said, almost 20,000 positions. And you can see the bottom section shows you, breaks it out by European versus American. And you see all the growth is in that European. So, and then one last slide. Oh, this is there something after. I think after Mr. Speed. One last slide. Some things that I'm excited about that we're talking about kind of on a daily basis. Probably the most exciting extended hours. I think we're going to see it. There's plenty of brokers, and you know, the kind of it seems to all be coming together in terms of, you know, SPX and VIX actually are tradable almost around the clock now because the futures are open and people are kind of comfortable with it. You know, as you see more overnight equities trading with Blue Ocean and there's an exchange that's trying to get off the ground, you're going to see the ability for overnight options to trade. You basically just can't trade options until there's a stock, until the market for the stock is available as well. The other thing I think that I would point out that I'm very excited about, I think is will kind of shift the paradigm, is this quoted spread book concept. So the spread books are an interesting mishmash across all the exchanges. Not every exchange has one, but most do. And you, if you're trying to buy a vertical call spread, you can put it into the complex order book, your dollar bid, somebody can respond, they can hit you or not. But that's kind of all it does. And in fact, those complex order books aren't even really connected to the limit order books. So if the bid to offer quote is a dollar, but you're bidding a dollar in the complex order book, you actually don't get filled and people get really pissed off. The quoted spread book is going to change that. It's actually going to let market makers quote, dynamically quote complex orders. We're starting it with box spreads in SPX, which is a real simple starting point. It's effectively just an interest rate type of trade. But this is kind of the beginning, I think, because if you can start to look at, if you've ever looked at a brokerage platform and turned it over to from an option chain to verticals or even to condors or something, a lot of the platforms support this, and it's pretty cool, except that the bid offers are terrible. When you really go from offer to bid to offer on a three-way, you end up with a crazy wide market, and it's ugly. The complex, the quoted spread book is going to let participants actually quote that. So all of a sudden, this box, which if you quoted it from the market, might be $6 wide on a 1,000-point box, is all of a sudden going to be 15 cents wide when you're looking at this, the quoted spread book quote. And the ability to see it, get comfortable with it, click the button and say, okay, I'll buy that one. It prints like any other trade. But to be able to keep an eye on that trade without having to go back and do the math of connecting the legs, I think is going to really change things up. So, and then the last thing, cross-product spreads, I think is actually kind of cool too, which is right now you cannot... you can't trade an Apple option against a Tesla option if you want to in a complex order. It's against the rules. That particular thing is not, we're not there yet, but the needle is moving in terms of being able to trade one option product against another. And in fact, in Flex, coming soon, at least on SIBO, is the ability to trade a listed against a Flex, meaning if you want a dollar put spread in a product that only has $2.50 strikes, then you just trade it listed versus flex. There's no problem. So one of the guys on my team said, you know, that the flex and listed markets are kind of on a collision course. And I think that the complex order book comes into that. So maybe it's a three-way collision. But you really have this confluence of things that people trade that are obviously interconnected, except they're not efficiently connected in the market. That's what I got. Thank you for the time. And everybody have a good time.
You're listening to the Options Insider Radio Network, the home of the Options Podcast. For more quality options programs, visit theoptionsinsider.com or search for Options Insider Radio Network in your podcast provider of choice. Listeners can also access all of our programming through our mobile app available in the iTunes and Google Play stores. Select programs are also available via live stream at Mixlr.com/options-insider. That's Mixlr.com/options-insider. Don't forget to follow along with your favorite programs and submit your own questions for the hosts at twitter.com/options, stocktwits.com/options, facebook.com/theoptionsinsider, or via questions@theoptionsinsider.com.